Okay. Thank you for your introduction. And also welcome from my side to this presentation. We and our collaborators, we are working on atomic force microscopy. You can see here on the right side of the slide, an AFM system with which we are working. Really, a good thing of the AFM is you can visualize the smallest structures in the sub-nanometer range. So for the lateral resolution, we achieve as low as 1 angstrom, which is a tenth of nanometer, and the vertical resolution can even be 10 times smaller at 0.1 of an angstrom. One really good thing about AFM is that there is no special requirement on the sample or on the environmental environment. For example, the sample does not need to be conductive, or we do not need to measure in vacuum. So we can measure at ambient condition, which makes the technique an ideal candidate to be used in life science applications to visualize biological samples. One goal is we want to realize real-time observation of cellular processes, for example, dynamics of proteins and so on. Important for bioapplication is that we have small forces on the sample, so we don't want to destruct the sample, and obviously we want to have a high frame rate to enable the real-time imaging. Here you can see a sample from material science, which usually takes in the order of time in the order of minutes to be sampled. But what you can see here, this is sample myosin-5 protein, which one frame only takes less than a second to sample. The challenge for us now is to eliminate all speed bottlenecks in the system to realize this high-speed imaging. And we try to increase the speed for any standard system. Okay, so here on the lower part of the slide, we see the basic principle of an AFM system. It consists of a cantilever with a sharp tip attached at its end, and this cantilever is scanning across the sample in a raster fashion. Due to the attractive and repulsive forces between the tip and the sample, the cantilever is being deflected, and we then measure the deflection, most commonly with the so-called beam deflection method, and demodulate this deflection signal then in our demodulation electronics. The demodulated signal is fed to the AFM controller and fed back to the cantilever in order to keep a constant deflection of the cantilever by means of adjusting the height of the sample with a set piezo. In bioapplications, we usually work at the, in the tapping mode AFM, which reduces the forces which act on the sample. In the tapping mode, the cantilever, which is here, is oscillating near its resonance frequency while the cantilever is moving across the sample surface. Here, you can see the resulting oscillation signal, or schematically, for such a grating, which where you can see here, there is a higher amplitude and a lower amplitude depending on the height of the sample. For a fast imaging, obviously, we want to have a fast moving of the cantilever across the sample, which results in fast changes of the amplitude. And this is what we want to achieve. We want to achieve more or less a detection of the amplitude within one single cycle of the oscillation, what is here schematically. So it is quite hard to achieve this this demodulation to use the entire available bandwidth of the cantilever. What we do to achieve this is we use an upconversion of the baseband signal onto a higher intermediate frequency, which is depicted here in the frequency domain. The original cantilever resonance frequency and the signal band around it is converted via the LO frequency to the higher higher frequency. We implement single sideband upconversion to avoid the second unwanted sideband, and also to avoid the usage of sharp filters in the intermediate frequency band. The demodulation then is performed at this higher intermediate frequency. Our proposed prototype consists of four basic building blocks. We have the single sideband upconverter, which is here as the IQ modulator. We have a synchronous amplitude detector, then some IM output stages, and also the LO synthesizer is implemented in our system, which gets some feedback from the AM output to conveniently configure to its needs. Additionally, we have some phase demodulation output, which are not used at the moment in our system. For the single sideband up conversion, the most crucial part is the generation of the IQ signal, of the projection signals for this modulation. In our system, we use a polyphase filter to realize this IQ generation. Of course, for the polyphase filter, there is a trade-off between the bandwidth, which is for us quite high. We want to work between 100 kHz and 10 MHz, which is a relative value of 100. Trade-off then between the bandwidth, the rejection of the underside sideband, and of course the noise. We realized our polyphase filter 8 stages. For the mixer, we used the ADE1, which is a commercially available mixer with a typical isolation of 55 dB. So we said we want to have at least then 50 dB suppression of the underside sideband and overall signal-to-noise and distortion ratio. So with 8 stages, we achieved this specification. We can see here the simulation, Monte Carlo simulation, with all parasitic parasitics of our system. For the quadrature signal generation, we also designed a polyphase filter. However, here the specifications are much more relaxed since we only need to work for our system between 30 and 40 megahertz. The relative bandwidth is much more relaxed and 3 stages were sufficient. We achieved the quite good performance by a totally symmetric layout of the polyphase filters. You can see here the H-stage polyphase filter in the windmill fashion for the input signal, and also the small polyphase filter with only 3 stages for the local oscillator generation. Apart from the polyphase filter, our system, or from the IQ modulator in general, our system consists of a synchronous amplitude detector with a PLL for the carrier recovery at 40 megahertz, which we designed here, a bandpass followed by an adjustable phase shifter. Afterwards, the two signals are mixed to get the demodulated signal, and this output is then followed by subsequent adjustable output stages in gain and bandwidth. Now here, some measurements, some electrical measurements for the characterization. We generated a synthetic AFN signal with a carrier frequency of 5 megahertz, different modulation indices. And the important or the interesting measurement here are the two lines. But here, you can see we are able to demodulate close to the carrier frequency of 5 megahertz up to approximately 3 megahertz. The transfer function is more or less flat, indicating a single sideband demodulation. For the AFM measurements, we used as a sample the materialization of a compact disc. The setup was as follows. We used a commercial multi-mode 8 from Kruker, which was not modified at all, with a Nanoscope 5 AFM controller, a cantilever with a resonance frequency of approximately 1.6 megahertz, and we used our system, our demodulation electronics, to demodulate the signal from the top minus bottom signal from the deflection measurement. We fed our demodulated signal into the AFM controller, which then generated the feedback signal for the Z piezo, and reconstructed the image from our demodulated signal. The results are shown here. On the top, you can see the reference measurement with the Kruker system. So we use the Kruker also the login from Booker to generate these figures and to reconstruct the figures, the pictures. The lower part is our system. Always on the left, we see the topography. On the right, the arrow signal. The Booker system is limited to 20 kilohertz bandwidth for the image reconstruction. For us, we use the setting of 1 megahertz for the image reconstruction. And what you can see, or what you can hardly see, is there is the pictures are more or less the same, so we don't see any additional noise compared to the reference signal. Main limitation still available in this setup here is the overall feedback bandwidth from the Booker system, which we cannot change, which is limited to 20 kilohertz, but the reconstruction for our system was made at 10 megahertz. And this feedback bandwidth also, of course, limits our imaging speed in general. So now the conclusion, we demonstrated the plug-and-play prototype of a single cycle AM-AFM demodulator and demonstrated its capabilities measurements. The system is ready for current and next generations of high-speed cantilevers up to approximately 9 megahertz. The noise floor is compatible with the state of the art, and our next steps are to use the single cycle demodulation also for the AFM experiments, to use very high resonance frequency cantilevers and higher mode detection. And for that, we want to go for photothermal excitation in contrast to the commonly used piezo excitation of the cantilever. Thank you for your attention.